Homeownership is the dream for most of us in America, but in LA, does it actually make sense? Homeownership does have tax benefits, you build equity in your home, and you're able to lock in a mortgage rate that's not gonna go up over time, unlike rent.
But when renting, you don't have to pay for maintenance, the monthly cost is often lower with today's interest rates, and you have more flexibility.
But which is actually the better choice financially? What I've learned from owning a home myself is you actually have to run the numbers for every different situation.
And today, we're gonna take a look at a condo for sale in LA and see if it would make more sense to buy or to rent.
And also, if you guys are interested in buying in the greater Los Angeles area or even Palm Springs, I am a real estate agent here now, and I'd be happy to talk to you even if you're in those beginning phases of figuring out, does buying even make sense? You want to run the numbers? I'll have my email on the screen and down below. You can shoot me an email if you're interested, and I'll be happy to get back to you and talk about it. We're in Westwood, which is a pretty desirable area in LA. It's known mostly for UCLA, but there's a lot of dense housing here. So a lot of condos, some single family houses.
This is a nice neighborhood on the west side of Los Angeles. So at the $1 million price point, you're almost always looking at a condo. This is a 2-bed, 2.5-bath condo that's almost 1600 square feet. So really large for a condo.
Check out the main living space. Pretty big. You can see you've got the living area over to the right and then a full dining area here as well. You can tell that this unit was renovated and it feels modern. Something fun, this little bar area. There's a sink, so it's an actual wet bar. Really fun for entertaining. It does look out to a building. At this price point, with this much square footage, you're probably not gonna get the top floor unit in a building. It's sort of a trade-off. Like, this is almost 1600 square feet.
And there are units for sale at this price point that are on a higher floor and have a ton of natural light. It just usually would have less square footage.
But you'll notice there is recessed lighting all throughout, which does help brighten up the space. Heading out here, there's like a full outdoor patio.
So this is a pretty unique outdoor area. It's almost like a courtyard in the middle of the building, but it brings some light into the kitchen, so I like this.
So here's the kitchen. You can tell it's definitely been updated from when this was initially built. It doesn't come with a fridge, which I think is interesting that the sellers are taking that with them. So that's something that would need to be purchased.
Usually a renovated condo like this would come with all the appliances, so this is a bit unusual.
Different parts of LA I've seen at this same exact price point, the kitchens aren't renovated and they're from the 70s. So actually really nice that this one is. Got areas to cook all over there. You've got like a coffee bar area. So let's check out the bedrooms. They're actually really, really big. So here's the first one.
Because the unit is almost 1600 square feet and only 2 bedrooms, they're very generous sized bedrooms.
Both of the bedrooms have ensuite bathrooms. So there is no bathtub in this bathroom, but very cool renovated shower. I like the tile choice in here. This isn't even the primary bedroom, but it kind of feels like it would be. A lot of the new construction homes have tiny bedrooms, so it's cool to see that this one is quite big. Like, you could have a king bed if you want.
And then the other bedroom and bathroom is the primary suite.
When you walk in, you've got not one, but 2 closets. So good sized closet in here that's like built out a little bit. And then same size over here.
This room also has a hallway going into the bedroom, and this one is even bigger than the other bedroom. Definitely can fit a king size bed.
This one also has an ensuite bathroom, but this bathroom is kind of massive. Come check it out.
So you enter into this first room that has the sinks and another storage closet area. And then the rest of the bathroom is separated into a different room, which is nice to just keep the humidity contained in one room.
This bathroom, you get actually a separate bathtub from the shower, which is pretty cool. And it's renovated. The tile choices are pretty fun. It still feels modern.
In general, it was very spacious. The bathroom and really the whole master suite was quite large. And then at the entryway, there's also a powder bath. So this is just one example of what $1 million can get you in this specific neighborhood. Now let's look at the numbers and see who buying makes more financial sense for versus renting.
If you put 20% down, which would be $209,000, at today's interest rates, the mortgage, including property taxes, insurance, HOA dues, would be $7,700. And the rental estimate on Zillow says $4,500 a month to rent. But you can't really trust these, because when I looked for rentals, there was similar square footage for $4,500 a month, but very dated. When I actually found this square footage and this updated, it was closer to $5,500 a month. Obviously, at face value, it's much cheaper to to rent than to own, but there's a lot of things to consider here that I didn't really get into in my last video about buying versus renting, and that is tax benefits and leverage.
When you factor in the tax deductions you can get from owning a home and paying interest on a mortgage, it actually makes a big difference in the net monthly amount
you pay. When you own a property, there are tax deductions you can take that you just can't with renting. First off, you've got property taxes. At least in California, you can deduct up to $10,000 per year of your property taxes that you pay.
And you can also deduct mortgage interest up to $750,000.
And this can vary state by state, so check with your CPA on these things, but I'm going with California. So with this property, you would get $68,000 of tax deductions a year. And let's say that you are making $200,000 a year, because that's probably what you would need minimum to afford to buy this. In that tax bracket, this would give you an annual savings of about $16,000. When we spread that savings out over the 12 monthly payments, that brings your net payment to about $6,400. So you do still have to pay the $7,700, but when we factor in these tax savings, it's similar to if you were spending $6,400, but just know you would still need to have the $7,700 upfront to pay.
And then there's also the fact that you gain equity with each monthly payment.
And here's where buying really starts to get interesting. So as a lot of people know, every payment that you make towards the mortgage, a portion of that goes to paying down the principal. And with this condo in the first 5 years, you would pay off about $50,000. So you would have $50,000 more of equity. So that $209,000, you now have $259,000 in equity. And this is where it gets really good, is the home appreciation, the leverage of having a $1 million loan that appreciates at 3.78%. Now there are down markets, there are times where homes don't appreciate, but historically, when I look at how this condo has appreciated, it's been about 3.78% per year.
Note that this is if the condo sells at the asking price. If it sells for less, the rate will be lower as well. And according to the Case-Shiller Index, condos have appreciated about 6% a year for the last 29 years. We're gonna factor this, but we're gonna calculate this with this.
So we're assuming it appreciates at that same rate. That's about $40,000 per year that it would appreciate, making the value of this condo after 5 years about $1.2 million. So let's say after 5 years, you wanna sell this house. You would have $789,000 left on the loan. You'd likely be able to sell it for about $1.2 million. When you include the realtor fees, let's be conservative and say you are paying the buyer's agent and the seller's agent, that would be around $60,000, could be less of a fee than this, then you'd now be at $414,000. Now, what about taxes? Well, this is the beauty of real estate. You wouldn't pay taxes on any of the gains up to $250,000 of your primary residence. So there is a capital gain of $248,000 on that sale, but you wouldn't pay taxes on any of it as long as you lived in this property. That's insane, and that's like the big benefit really of real estate. So that $414,000, it would stay that number. However, I do want to factor in one more thing, and that's maintenance. It's a phantom cost. I'm gonna assume maybe there was $30,000 in maintenance over the 5 years that you had to pay for. We're gonna make the final amount you'd walk away with after 5 years about $384,000. Now it could be more, could be less, depending on the market, the maintenance, everything. This is a projection based on historical data. And let's see if renting and putting money in the stock market can beat it.
So remember our numbers when renting was $5,500 a month for an equivalent property. And because you don't have to put money as a down payment, you have $209,000 that you can invest.
Of course, you have the benefit of putting that down payment into the stock market instead, and you could get an average of 10% a year on that. So we're gonna factor that in because that is an opportunity cost when you go to buy and a benefit of renting. We're also gonna factor in if you put the savings that you got from renting into the stock market, because it's a little less expensive to rent than to own. But let's say you put all of that into the stock market each month. That's a great benefit. However, rent typically goes up. In LA, there are rent caps. Usually it's not gonna go up more than 3% per year. And in the past, when I've lived in bigger buildings, it was about 3%, so that's what we're gonna go with. So here's a look at the first 5 years of what you're gonna pay in rent, and you can see when we get to year five, it's getting pretty close to that net mortgage payment when you include in the tax benefits. And here's how much that would end up being each year in contribution contributions to the stock market. And when all of this compounds after 5 years, it does get to a sizable amount, $378,000. But if we're factoring in taxes to the real estate equation, we've got to factor it into this too. If you were to sell these stocks, you are going to have to pay taxes on the gain. These are long-term capital gains, so the brackets are lower than ordinary income. Say that you end up paying in the 15% tax bracket. That means you would pay about $20,000 in taxes on your gains. So the actual amount you would walk away with here would be about $357,000. Not too shabby. Like, that's pretty great.
So these are the numbers 5 years later. As you can see, owning did a little bit better financially, but these are just projections. Who knows? The stock market in reality could do better. Homes could also appreciate even more. We don't really know. All we can do is estimate with the historical data that we have.
So since the numbers are pretty similar, who is buying better for right now and who is renting better for? So it kind of just comes down to if you prefer the unit that you can buy versus rent. I would say buying is right for somebody who actually plans to live in the unit for 5 years or more. Because if you were to only live in this unit for a couple years and then rent it out, you might lose money each month. But the numbers do start to make sense when you factor in the tax benefits if you're actually living in the property, especially if you are earning a higher income. I think it can also make sense if you plan to refinance later when interest rates eventually come down, which who knows when that is. It could be a long time. There's really no guarantees there, but you're locking in a lower price because when interest rates go down, usually prices go up. That would be an ideal situation if you have a lower price, and then you can refinance to a lower interest rate later. I think renting makes more sense probably for most people if you want to move around more. And also if you're someone who actually has the financial discipline to invest the difference that you would be saving by renting instead of having a mortgage. The issue is most people don't actually have that financial discipline. They'll find a way to spend the money. But if you are someone who already invests money that you're not spending every single month, then it would probably make more sense for you to just rent and invest the difference. They both are good options, I think. They both carry some risks, but I think being aware of these things and doing your research will help you make the right decision for you, because at the end of the day, only you are gonna know what's right for you. All right, I hope that you guys enjoyed this video and learned something. Comment down below your experience with homeownership or buying or selling. I'd love to hear about it, or your take on the LA real estate market.
And if you are looking to buy or sell in LA and you wanna learn more about it, you can email me here. I'll also have it in the description.
And I'll see you guys in my next video. Bye.